In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to shoot handheld hyperlapses, but not with a wide-angle lens, but with a telephoto lens. And while that sounds complicated, it's actually much easier than you might think. What's the main difference between using this handheld and using a motorized slider? Well, first off, a motorized slider costs money and only has a limited range, for example, 1 meter, and you cannot move any further. And if I shoot handheld with this, I can move in between shots, for example, let's say 5 or even 10 meters, and get much more motion in the end. Now I'm going to show you different techniques and camera tools to get the best results when shooting handheld hyperlapses. Having a framing or grid assist tool in the camera really is useful, especially when it comes to architectural hyperlapses like what I'm shooting right now. So as you can see, there's a bridge right here, there are buildings in the background, and if I want to focus on something specifically, I want to make sure it's always centered, always framed the right way. Those lines really make sense and they really help to get the best possible results. One of the most common issues when it comes to shooting hyperlapses handheld is actually that the leveling is off. So to avoid that, you usually have a tool like I have right here, a spirit level, it's going to show green. If I tilt it towards the side, it's going to go off. And that can be a real issue, especially because you move between shots. So make sure that the level is always properly centered. Otherwise, it can be very tricky to get good results in post. While precise framing is very, very important, it also is important to follow a certain path and make sure you don't go off to weird directions. And for example, those white stones here on the floor can help me in making sure I always move the same distance, I always move on the same path. So I could stop on one end of the stone, take a shot, move again, take a shot. Of course, always make sure you frame the same way, take a shot and so on. So that can really get you much better results than if you just walk somewhere on the floor and you don't have a clear path. So make sure, for example, those tracks could help, those stones or any sort of grid. To avoid camera shakes and blurry results, it definitely helps to either have internal image stabilization in the lens or the camera, or also make sure to double your shutter speed. So for example, if you shoot at 100 millimeter, your shutter speed should be 1/200th of a second. While there is no wrong type of camera for this kind of shoot, you can even use your smartphone, although I wouldn't recommend it because probably the telephoto range is not going to be that good. And another reason is actually how comfortable it is to hold, because if I use a big camera like this with a battery grip, yes, it can be a little heavy, but if I have to hold it for 30 minutes, the grip actually makes a big difference. And I also have the EVF, which means I can hold it up to my eye. I have additional stabilization here. So having a bigger camera in this case, I personally think is a better choice. The reason I'm not using a photo tripod like this is, first off, it takes much more time to set up. Even though, yeah, you could say, well, it's not that complicated. Well, you need to be precise when it comes to telephoto hyperlapses because the framing changes easily. And what that means is, first off, I need to move the tripod between shots, and then I also need to rearrange the ball head each time. So if you have time, it definitely makes sense because on a cold day like this, it definitely is more relaxing. And of course, if I want to shoot long exposure stuff, it is also the better solution. But when it comes to traveling and if you want to get a fast workflow, I think shooting handheld is the better option. Post-processing is pretty much the same as when editing a static photo time-lapse. You need to stitch all those images together into one video sequence. I usually do that in Adobe After Effects, but there are lots of different tools, also free tools to do that. And of course, stabilization is important. It's not always important to have a very strong stabilization. So usually if you get some good results while shooting, for example, framing everything properly, also making sure that the level is not off, that can help get some good results. And if there is some sort of wobble effect when applying something like warp stabilizer, make sure to try different stabilization modes and the results should be good. I hope you enjoyed this little hyperlapse tutorial and I'll see you next time. Bye.